the good starting point from here, and of course we are basing our stuff off the question. I think it would be good to start on valuation issues, going to the freshest exam that we have, and this is of course October PM 2020. And the question that I wanna that will put us in the context is the question number 78. By the way, if you notice valuation questions over here, they are somewhat misleading because not all of them deal with value. Some of them deal with entry type. So appraisement entry, we have a as we are going into that second volume, we have a whole chapter on appraisement entry, which is separate. Then we also have GSP, which is free trade agreements. So remember, the assignments today were free trade agreement stuff. So this is something that you guys also keep in mind, that this is not, I mean, it relates to valuation, but it's really FTA stuff. And the Indian Trade Preference Act is also one of those guys that would be in a totally different place, not in the in the valuation chapter. But what would be in the valuation chapter would be the question 78. And this is a question that I want to start our discussion with. And as we can see, when we're going down to the evaluation strategy, recall that you have to really start reading from the question. So the question first, and it usually comes at the end of the narrative. Skim through the answers A through E, and then, now that you are having a choice of values, you start reading the actual text. And one of the things that you are here being asked, and this is a classic example of questions that appear on the topic on customs license broker examination, is what's the transaction value? And transaction value, of course, is part of that 151 part 19 CFR. And this is something that we need to kind of take a sneak peek at and see what's going on. And I think a good idea here would be to start with 152.01, basis of appraisement. And here we have methods. If you can see B, we have methods of appraisement. And the regulations, they give us six different methods of appraisement. And at the very top, you have transaction value. Then you have transaction value of identical merchandise, transaction value of the similar merchandise. Then you have deductive value, computed value, and the residual, you figure it out value, which are the basis of appraisement. Why is this so important? Because you are just like duties. The way you appraise the stuff that are coming in is extremely important from the vantage point of revenue collection, at least as far as customs can see that. It is also important because much of the trade is nowadays is dominated by the large multinational companies. And these multinational companies usually engage in what's commonly known as transfer pricing. So in other words, just again, not to oversimplify it too much, but let's say you have a related company in China, which is related to, let's say, Apple China, transfers its iPhones to Apple United States. Will it be declaring the value, which is, let's say, the if you go to the Apple store and you buy an iPhone, I don't know how much it costs. I'm not an iPhone user. I assume it's like $700, maybe more. So would you be declaring, would Apple Incorporated in the United States, would it be declaring that money, or would it be declaring something which would be lower? Because you know the incentive is for the Apple to declare it at a much lower value, because you have you pay less duties on this at the end of the day, correct? So well, this is the reason why valuation and methodology is so important. So in here, the as you can see, you have five different options to choose from, and option number one is the transaction value. The transaction value is probably 90% of the customs license broker exam questions, and this is because this is by far most popular, and this is by far most heavily tested topic on the exam. And as we saw by looking at the latest exam, examiners are looking at the transaction value. They are looking at that methodology. What do you do about that methodology right there? And then, of course, you have the other stuff, and they come in the order or order received, if you will. You have to start with this one. If this doesn't fit, you have to go to this one. If this doesn't fit, you have to go to this one. If this doesn't fit, you have to go to this one or this one. So five and four, you can switch around. And if that doesn't fit, you have to go to this one. So jump from one, two, three, four. Then you can choose either five or four, and six. So those are the options. By the way, the transaction value, the first one, if you have related parties that are being that I let's say from my hypothetical, you have subsidiary owned by Apple in People's Republic of China, let's say, then the transaction value is presumed to be not a proper value. So that's one of the things why this transfer value stuff is extremely important. Fortunately for us, you do not have to do that on a, well, they may ask you, but most of the time you don't have to do that on a customs broker exam. The likelihood that you'll be faced with a determination of transfer pricing between related companies and determination of declaration is not very big. If you go through the textbook, you will find some questions that were there, but they are very few in between. So let's talk about the transaction value and what it means. So transaction value method, and they actually tell you you need to jump to 152.103, is price actually paid or payable. So at the end of the day, this really means imagine yourself going to the store, right? You whatever it is you pay at the register, this is the amount that is price actually paid or payable. Let's say some folks I know have developed a relationship with a local small corner store, or let's say with a local bar, let's say, And let's say you're coming in and to the corner store, right? So I have a little bodega where I live, and one time I forgot the cash, and they have $7 minimum for the credit card, and all I wanted to do is just get a cup of coffee from them. And so I said, "Listen, guys, just you see me all the time. You know I'm from around here. Can I pay you a dollar? Wait, well, I think it's for the large cup. They charge $1.75 where I go. Yeah, so why don't can I pay you back that money later?" So this is where the payable stuff comes from. So did I pay him anything at that moment? No. But of course I will next time I see them. I will pay him, and I did that. Next time I had cash on me, I did pay him cash. So that way, they didn't had to pay the credit card companies. This way, it was convenient for me. So it's good for business because I keep coming back. So it works. So price actually paid or payable. Of course, one of the things. Which defines the price that is actually paid or payable, it can get quite complicated. So what I have done is I have designed, again, this is something which is which I call a quick reference chart. But this is not something which you guys should rely on as the ultimate document. This is just like quick guide. So I'm dropping down the link for you guys to download this chart. And what this chart simply says is, okay, so you have a transaction value. This is good for transaction value only, guys. So make sure that you are not using this if there is a question on deductive value or other stuff. But if you are in a transaction value world, what I find very helpful is to really have the line item or the laundry list, if you will, of the stuff which is included, or which the stuff which is excluded from the transaction value. So in here you can see you have exclusions such as X factory, foreign inland freight, ocean freight charges, marine insurance, customs broker charge. Those line items are not part of the transaction value. Yeah, I probably should send the link by email. Okay, I'll try. I highly recommend that you copy and paste that link though, because just make sure you guys copy and paste that link just in case. I will try to remember to do that. The idea here again is to create this laundry list was created based on the questions which were commonly asked by the customs examiners. This is not 100% bulletproof list, and sometimes it is kind of based on the buzzwords. In the customs and license broker exam, I know you guys would be tight of for time. It's a race against time, if you will. So here, it will be something which you use as a starting point, because sometimes customs examiners can mix things up, and as we shall see, this is something which they will be doing as a part of their attempt to make sure that you guys are having a wonderful time at an experience at the customs license broker exam. All right, so as promised, what we're going to do is I did some excerpts from that chapter 35. So I'll be using this book. I'm not going to cover all the questions, but I think I'll touch upon questions which are seem to be most important from my vantage point to and seem to be most common on a customs license broker examination. All right. So the first one that comes up is the one about paying attention to numbers. So you what you have is you have 860 dozen scissors. And again, I'm sorry, it's going to involve some mathematics. What I'll be doing is I'll be using the Excel spreadsheet for calculation purposes. I can as well use the calculator, but I just find using the Excel spreadsheet is better. So I'll be using that on the screen back and forth. But let me point some stuff out which I think are relevant here, and then we'll go on. So if you look at the end of the question, examiners are looking at the transaction value of the shipment. So just like at that question 78, which we will come back to at the once we finish through this run of the running through the chapter 35, we have the transaction value which customs examiners are looking for. So what's relevant here is how much you go to that 7501 and how much you declare, all right? And the numbers they give you, notice that they are not asking you for the duties. The numbers that they give you is they're giving you the 7477 per dozen, and you have 860 dozen scissors. So if you go to the outline, quick reference chart that I mentioned, quickly find out that this type of stuff is not listed because it's a given. That's why it's a quick reference. So this is the basic value. This is the basic starting point. So what you do is you multiply 7477 by 860. So I'll just write it out. I have it in a spreadsheet, but I'll just write it out for the sake of convenience. So now 860 by 77.74.77. Okay, please take a note, guys, that you have different point of references here too. First point of reference that you have here is the reference to something which is called a dozen, and then you have a reference to something which is called a unit. That is important because you the next thing you're going to be asked is you're going to be asked to find out how additions and exclusions from the transaction value. So the next thing you go is you go to again, you this is where exclusions begin. You have ocean freight, and then you have another ocean freight. And remember, price actually paid or payable. Okay, this is actual ocean freight. And this is something which is excluded from the shipment. Then you have insurance. You have estimate marine insurance. And then you have the actual insurance at five thousandths per unit. You always go with the actual insurance, not the estimate one, because it's price actually paid or payable. It's not the estimated stuff. So again, what is the value? All right, so let me bring up the spreadsheet. If I can grab it, yeah. Okay. So here is the calculation. Let me see if I can increase it a little bit so everyone can see what's going on. All right. So, notice we have quantity which includes 74.77 per dozen, and we have 860 dozens, right? So you multiply 860 by 74.77 and you get 64,302. And then you get to the insurance and ocean freight. And remember, insurance and ocean freight, they are excluded. So you take those babies out. And you take the actual price for the insurance. It's remember it was 5,000, and then you take quantity, but quantity, recall, it was 860. Look at the formula line. It was 860 by 12. Where do I get the 12? The 12 represents the dozen. Because you recall, if you go back to the question itself, you have that 5,000 per unit, not per dozen, and dozen represents 12. This is something that examiners do not tell you, and this is something which they imply you know. So I have, as you can probably tell by the accent, I was not born here, and I come from the country which uses the metric system. HTSUS uses a metric system, but the business practices within the United States, they do not use the metric system. So dozens is one of the common units in the United States. So keep that in mind. So you put together one. You put together the whole invoice, and you take out what is not supposed to be there, which is ocean freight, and which is the insurance. And of course, those insurance charges have to be real. So this is how you get to 5109. Of course, in here. Fifty-one 501 is rounded, and if you go to the entry summary, you will not be rounding it to that level. But the way the customs examiners kind of give you the stuff, and I know some of you have struggled with rounding because if you round too early, then you get to the answer, which is not part of the list. So this is always a trick, and unfortunately, customs here, the proper way for customs examiners to do this would be to really give you the rounding to the cents, right? But they didn't do that, and this is something that you're just going to have to adapt to. All right, so that's for question, and again, I'm at the chapter. Let me see. So I'm at chapter 33. Oh, I'm sorry, 35, page 454. All right, so that's the first one I wanted to run through. The next one I wanted to do is also. Is also dealing with transaction value. Recall the transaction value is the most popular one on the list. I'm on page 460 now of the textbook. And what we have is we have the invoice value, And we have all other stuff which are included in the invoice value. So we have CIF. By the way, if you guys, I know it's been some time, but if this CIF, or cost insurance and freight, and FOB, DDP, duty delivery paid, all those terms sound foreign to you, please go back to chapter number, seeing international commercial terms. It would be chapter somewhere in the beginning. Yeah, chapter 3. So all the way in the beginning of this book, you can skim through the chapter. I don't list all of the international commercial terms, and they change with time. If you look at the lecture, like a video supplement lecture, you'll find out that this is a creature of semi-private, quasi-private organization based out in Paris, International Chamber of Commerce, and they make their updates all the time. But those guys found their way into the world of customs broker exam sometimes by way of being codified into the CFR or by just business practices. So in this case, you have cost insurance and freight, which really represents the division between the responsibilities, who pays for what. On our end, as a licensed customs broker, you'll be asked to figure out what to add, what to subtract. And going back to the definition that we established from the beginning, let me see, 103. So price actually paid. One more thing I didn't mention. So transaction value says, so regulations do say it's price actually paid or payable, but then the actual definition of the for the price of actually paid or payable, you find in part 152, paragraph F. This is where you get this stuff, and you have a really just basic overview of what's included, what's excluded, and the main line item over here is the expenses incurred for transportation, insurance, and related services. The related services, of course, here would be brokerage charges, insurance charges. Those are the major ones, but not only. We have royalties, we have commissions. Incident to the international shipment of merchandise from country of exportation to country of importation. So that's, as long as it's incident, the general rule of thumb is that it is not included. And if you go to that, I don't think I have... I don't think I have entry summary. I'll pull it up later on. But you exclude those charges from the entry summary right next to that duty declaration column. So again, this is where we're at, and this is what's included to exclude. So using that chart, let's go back to our question. And so I'm gonna close this one out. Let's see. So we have invoice value of 1,000. We have cost insurance of freight. We have which includes 3,000 in air freight and 100 for insurance. Then you have the rate of duty, and then you have the MPF. So this is nice. So custom examiners actually break it down. They are not always that nice. But looking at this and looking at the chart that I provided, what I want you to be able to do, guys, is I want you to be able to say, okay, included, excluded right away. So invoice value, that's a starting point. But then you have air freight, you have which is excluded, Ocean freight is also excluded, but we're not dealing with that. Then you have 100 insurance, which is also taking out from that 100,000. And then you have duty rate payments, and then you have MPF rate payments. So those I need to be taking out. The real trick here is to really refresh your memory on us mathematics stuff back in school of how to go about it. Let me see if I can illustrate, if I did illustrate it yeah, I think I did. All right, so what do we have here? So lithium ion batteries, recall the invoice value is 100,000. So that is where we get to at some point. But before we do that, let me see. Oops. All right. So what we have is we have recall they were saying 3.4%. So to get the 3.4%, what you would do is you would go and you take out and you move the dots. So I'm sorry if I insult anyone's intelligence here. I don't mean to do that. Sometimes I find that this stuff is being forgotten. So you have 3.4%, and percent is a hundredth part of whatever, right? So what is a hundredth part of whatever? It is something divided by 100. That's a percentage. So to get rid of this percentage sign and convert it to the real number, you have to take it that dot twice, right? So 3.4% becomes this dot over here, and becomes 0.034, and you take that percentage out. So that's pretty much the basic stuff. The if you see the MPF rate, right, the 3.464, you also take the dot twice, so it will be 0.0012, right, from its original place, 3.464. Now, what's the deal? You know the total invoice. You know the final number that you need to get to over here. Is 100,000, and you know the stuff that you need. You have all the information here, but you need to do a little bit. You do not know what they call a transaction value, right here, and transaction value of the value, the starting point of the lithium ion batteries, and some people. You like to use different letters, but the way I was brought up back in, like, I don't remember, like third grade or something, use system of axes, right? So let's say cost, the transaction value of batteries, right, is X. So then you have the final invoice, which is 100,000, right? All right. So what you do is you say, all right, so how much duty is included? So you know it's the stuff is being included there, right? So what you do is you add them all up. So you have that, you convert it to a number. And this is how much duty you pay, right? So you have X, which is value of batteries, dollars, right? Plus the duty you pay, which is 3.4%, which is 0.0012, 3-4x, right? Because value of batteries times the percentage, this is how much duty you pay. Plus, you have 3-4-6-4%, again, you have that number, so you go, I'm running out of room, but let's say 0.003464x. So this is your duty, this is your MPF, merchandise processing fee, and you also have the insurance, which is 100, and you also have air freight, which is 3,000. There you go. Now you have the formula. Going back again, not to insult anyone's intelligence, I'm very sorry if I insult your intelligence, but basically, to bring stuff over the equal sign, right, you take it out with a negative. So what you do is you go with, you bring over 3,000, you subtract right here. To bring over 100, you subtract. Then you add all those x's up, and you'll get the following stuff, which I put down nicely instead of showing the soup to you guys on this Excel spreadsheet. All right. So what do we have here? So those axes that I talked about, if you add them all up, you're going to get the 1.03764x. Then you have all these guys, and what you do is you have a formula which I put on the board, which kind of looks like that. Those x's have been added up. And then you just go through that mathematical operations by bringing this on the, bringing 100 and bringing 3,000 on the other side with a minus sign. So you get 96,900, but you still have to deal with this x, which is the value of batteries, right? And 1.037464. And the way you do that is another mathematical operation. You, since this is times x, right? Times the value of batteries. You just divide this stuff over, so you bring this 1.03767464 over here, and you perform the dividing operation, and you get to that number, 93,483. So what we've done here is we divided, we identified what must be counted and what must be subtracted. The starting point is this values. The second point is to put them in the right formula. Going back to our first class, why did I recommend this to address those questions last? As soon as you see that, what is the transaction value, put a check minus and come back to it. Because those calculation stuff, they are the ones who do a lot of time. So, okay. So, Miss Abby, what part you don't understand the identification of what counts as a transaction value or what doesn't, or you don't understand that mathematical procedure? Let me know, because it kind of implies you have to know both. Oh, math. All right. So, Yeah, I'm not a good math teacher, but listen. So let's do it like that. So let me just bring it up on a bigger screen. All right, so you have an item which is batteries, and it costs so much. Of this item, you have what examiners provide you. Let me pull it up. Okay, what examiners provide you is the list of line items, and they give you the total, right? So they say, all right, so check this out. You have 100,000. So you know that the total invoice, like the total, you have 100,000. So at the end, you have total 100K. K stands for thousand. And you know that within that 100K, you have a bunch of stuff which are included. So if I'm going to make a drawing like 100,000, what's included there? We know we have value of batteries, right? Which we need to find out. That lithium-ion batteries. So batteries. We have. We know that it's included because CIF duty paid. And MPF is included, so examiners do tell us it's included. Sometimes they tell us it's excluded, but here we know that insurance is included. Insurance. Then we have merchandise processing. No, I'm sorry, air freight. Because CIF duty paid. We have merchandise processing fee, which is also included. And we have the duty rate, which is also included. And we have, that's it, right? That's all it tells us. So, okay, now what we need to do is we have numbers to play with. But what our end point of inquiry is batteries. We have to know how much are the batteries within that line item, the total line item. We do know something about the other stuff, right? We know that insurance is 100. So this is the ultimate question, how much? But if you add them all up, this will be 100K, 100,000. But we need to take this pie apart, and we need to make sure that we identify with zero on batteries. So far, so good. Now, insurance. Examiners tell us insurance is pretty easy. It's $100. We also tell us that air freight is 3,000. Examiners don't tell us how much the merchandise processing fee and how much the duties. They don't give us the actual number, but they do give us percentages, and that's good enough. We'll see why. So, duty 3.4, MPF, so 3.4%. And MPF is 3464%. All right. So now we can start dealing with that formula stuff. So we know, for example, that part of that 100,000K is air freight and insurance. So here's what we can do. We can reduce that pie by the air freight piece. And we can reduce that, so that's 100,000, right? That's 100,000 pi, right? So here's what we're going to do. We're going to reduce this by the air freight piece, which is 3,000. And we're going to reduce it by insurance piece, which is 100. So what's left? 100,000 minus 3,000, it will be 97,000 minus minus 100, it will be 96,900, right? 96,900. That's the amount in the pi left, right? And this is when I go to that spreadsheet. This is that number over here, 96,900, because I keep on reducing that pi. But now I still need to figure out how much of that pi is merchandise processing fee, the duty rate, and the batteries. So how do I figure out? Because all I know is the percentages. So I know batteries is part of that pie which has been left. I need to so let's call it well, I'm not going to jump to that. We know that we have batteries. We know that we have 0.3464 MPF. And we know that we have 3.4% duty. So we don't know this, we don't know this, we don't know this, but we do know that if you add them all up, we're gonna get 96,900. All right, so the question now becomes, how do we separate out batteries from merchandise processing fee and from the duty? Well, this is done by we use in basic mathematics. What we do is we take them out by assigning the percentages. So, for example, if you knew the how much the batteries are, let's say they cost $100, right? Let's say the batteries cost $100. So those batteries, you pay, how much duty are you paying on $100 of the batteries? Well, you know you pay 3.4% duty, which is $3.40. Right? And you pay fraction of a dollar, right? So it would be like 35 cents if you rounded up, because you multiply that by 100. So this is if we had 100, but we actually don't. But customs examiners are not telling us how much batteries are. They want you to figure this out. So what you're doing is you are not using that 100, but you substitute that 100 with imaginary number or imaginary letter, and then you apply the formula. So what we're going to do, so I'm going to take this stuff out, and I'm going to take out question marks, and I'm going to say batteries, imaginary, it can be X if you like, Z for zebra, you can call it a zebra. If you like B for batteries, you can call it batteries, but it doesn't matter. It's just some number which is attached to, right? And that number is X. I just feel comfortable with X, right? So that X, if it is represents 100, right? Percent. Because while looking, this is the starting point. Remember, I told you the percentages is 100. If you want to convert percentages to a number, you get 100 part of something, right? So in other words, if you want to take percentages out of here, you go two over. You divide it by 100. Because definition of percentage is 100 part of something. So here, what you do is, if the batteries is 100, you divide it, you get 1. 100 divided by 100 is 1, right? Then here the percentages is, you do the conversion. So for duty it is would be 0.034 x, because that's how you get that one separated out, and you get also this is two times over. It would be 0.003464. The next step, of course, is you are going to add them all up. If you add up 3464, if you add this number, if you add this number, and you add this number, you get the remainder of the pi. And these numbers you can add up because they all have x's on top of them, attached to them, right? Because to get the percentages, you have to multiply them by 100. So now you have a formula. And the formula is right there. So this particular number includes percentage of batteries, which is 100. It also includes the MPF percentage, which is 3.64. It also includes the duty percentage, which is 3.4%, if you add it all up. So now, how do you get that particular X out? Well, usually if you have, so I'm gonna take this stuff out. And then usually if you have a number times X, which is in our case the batteries, equals to 96,900, the way you get X separated out is you bring it over. And you bring it over here. So in our case, what you bring over is you bring over 1.037464. You bring it over, and you plug the numbers in your calculator. Although, I think it will be good practice also to write it out, because it trains our brains. And once you do that, you arrive to that number, 93,483. Now, going to our answer choice, that's the number because it's rounded, 93,401. So this is pretty much the math part which I use. So what we can do is again, this is this stuff is I know it's been a while because we took math classes when we were kids, and some of us may not use that, and for some of us it may be time for recollection. What we can do is, if you are struggling in math part, because custom examiners, they are kind of sneaky too, they presume that you know the math part. If you're struggling in the math part, shoot me the email, we'll send some time out, which is gonna go through it. We're just gonna go through that formula shifting and all that other stuff. So that way, we do this. Yeah. So, it's kind of useful. A lot of math stuff, and which many kids found boring. They're much useful in the real life. For example, some Home Depot employees, if they know tangent, cotangent, and they know the trigonometry stuff, they can figure out the right angle and the right area. And this is something which is helpful for them. And I've known one gentleman, he got a raise that way, because he was a student, he just went in there, and he was good at cutting the right pieces. So basically, this is the useful stuff to know. So guys, for math, of how this formula works, if this is something which is still foreign language, the math part, not the part on the question, then we have to have a mathematics session, but we'll do that in one-on-one, because the idea here is to get the transaction value additions and subtractions. All right, so the next one, page 461, we have discounts. This question deals with the discounts, and the core of the question is, you have the ABC that purchases 10,000 glass vases from the overseas trading company, and the core of the question, and if you can see, they give you staggered pricing, right? Because if you buy more, you get a bigger discount. So that's pretty much how this works. And they're asking you what the transaction value is. So here, the idea is to figure out what the transaction value for that particular vases. And we know that we have actual price of payable is 10,000. So within that 10,000, it will be that it falls between that third stagger. So whenever ABC Incorporated made that purchase, it purchased it with a 10% discount. And recall, the transaction value is the price actually paid or payable. So what happens there? You get that 10% discount. So how much is he buying? He's buying 10,000. Three doors. He's buying 10,000 vases, three doors per vase. So that's 30,000, right? So that's the starting point. Then you have 10% discount. What's 10% of 30,000? 10% of 30,000 is 3,000, right? Guys, should I explain the mathematics how you get $3,000 dollars here? Let me know. We're all here to learn, so please let me know. Because 90% is how much? Is 27,000. If you add them all up, This is what you get, 3,000. Oh, I'm sorry, 30,000. This is the total. It is includes that particular stagger and includes that. That's the discount. Discount is the one of the items you take off, so you get 27. Okay, so I think we're good. What I find useful, again, I do the stuff in my head, but what I find useful sometimes, if it gets complicated, you can get systems. I like to have proportions. So let's say you have 30,000. That's 100%. And let's say you want 10%. You want to figure out what the 10% is. What I find useful, again, it's just me. There are different ways to do this, but what you have is you have crisscross system. We call it the system of proportions in mathematical terms. And the proportion is just like what the name suggests. You figure out the proportional value of what this is. And so this would be x. This would be unknown. So how do you figure out x? The way to figure out the proportion is to cross multiply. So you multiply 10 by 3,000 and divide by 100. This will be the x. Cross multiply. So whatever you have, whatever numbers you have available, you multiply them, and whatever numbers you have unavailable, you divide it. So to in other words, the proportion would tell me, okay, you take 30,000, you times the 10, and you divide it by 100, and that would be that 10 percentage. That would be that the percentage you're looking for. And the reason why, I mean, I know this stuff we can do in our head, but the same thing will work in the case, let's say, you have this weird 13.64% duty, right? So this is percentage, this is percentage. The same concept, you cross multiply. You take 13.64, you multiply it by 30,000 and you divide by 100 and you get that number, which will represent that particular portion. Okay. So Miss Abby, the order for the 3,000, the order is you need to figure out how. In here, the order is pretty simple. So this in this situation, you have, you need to take out 10% because discount is taken out from the transaction value. So in here, you need to simply convert percentages to the numbers. So this is what you do. You put in 10%. You cross multiply, you convert it to number. So multiply 10 by 30,000 and divide by 100. You should get 3,000. And that's the number. So you get 3,000. And that's the number you subtract from this total. Because this is a discount, which will equal 27,000. That's because this is a discount. Discount is not part of the transaction value because this is not a price actually paid or payable. This is the deal that you got by going for what, the 10,000 pieces which falls within that third stagger, third bullet point stagger, and you're it, 27. Okay. So, next one. Rose Enterprises. Okay, let me see. So we have a Chinese supplier, Rose Enterprises. We also have the US importer, Thurn Incorporated. They agreed to pay for the sale of the widgets. It can be anything. Free on board, another Incoterm, to Chicago. But Rose Enterprises owed a $20,000 debt to a third-party flour corporation. So what happened is they decided to strike a deal. They said, listen, why don't you take care of that flour, the Chinese supplier. So why don't, to the US importer, to US importer, said, why don't you take care of that flour corporation debt, and I'll cut you a deal. So your invoice will actually say 80,000, but there was other stuff which are involved, and this other stuff in this case is an example of indirect payment. Okay. So the question is, and notice they here is kind of tricky because they are not looking for the transaction value, because transaction value would be 90,000, right? What they are doing is they are looking for the, well, actually, sorry, they are looking for the transaction value of imported widgets, but they are not giving you the invoice total. In other words, they that's what I meant. I'm sorry. In other words, they are not saying that, okay, your invoice total is 110,000. You figure it out. They are giving you the direct transactions, the information about direct transactions that is going on. And they look like this. So, by looking at the chart that I provided, this would be indirect payment. And if you look at the chart of what's included in the transaction value, the indirect payment is like right after the discounts. We talked about the discounts because whatever you take, you discounts, in this case, you gave the last hypo, or the last question from the CBLE, was discount was minus $3,000, right? So that's included in the transaction value. In a way, it's excluded, right, mathematically speaking, but it's a part of the transaction value calculation. Indirect payment is also part of the transaction value calculation. So here what we got. We got the US importer, Thurn. He wants to get, he wants to buy widgets. He pays 100,000, of which he going to split, gonna pay 80,000 to the actual Chinese supplier Rose, and he going to pay 20,000 to flour. because rose and flower, they have outstanding 20,000 balance in favor of flower. So that way, between rose and flower, this can close. This can close out. But for Thurn, it doesn't matter because he's still pulling out 100,000 and he's still paying for that widget. It's just an accounting, right? He pays 80,000 and 20,000. It just he pays it to a third party. And because that's part of the equation, this is something which is to be counted for. So indirect payments, they're part of the transaction value. Yes, Katya, that's right. So what is the transaction value of the importer of widgets? That's 100,000. So the question is, should you include that shipping cost, 10,000, as a part of the transaction value? And the question is no. The answer is no. Because that is excluded. But it was probably paid for. Who is our guy, the importer, right? Because FOB usually implies that the importer pays. So I think what you're going to, Katya, is the question is, why isn't that 10,000 for the shipping cost is not part of the equation? Well, here, because the transaction value, recall, is price actually paid or payable for the merchandise, right? Shipping cost is not part of the transaction value if you look at the column 2. But indirect payments are part of the transaction value if you look at the column 1 of the chart I gave you. So $10,000 you do not count, but the $20,000 you do count, because at the end of the day, whatever you have happening as a part of the background should be included, because this was part of the negotiation. So unlike other questions that we saw with the invoice total, we know that we are not given, remember that excess and the formula calculation that we used, we are not doing that here, because in the fact pattern, they do not provide us with the invoice, duties paid and all that other stuff. They only provide us, but they do provide us with the exact amount that Thurn paid or agreed to pay, actually paid or payable for this widget. So the confusing portion here is who is the final recipient of this $100,000. And in fact, because they canceled the debt, the Rose is final recipient of this $20,000 by way of debt cancellation. But this is something which is not part of a transaction value because it's called indirect payment. You understand? So yeah. No, 120. No. So, okay. So let's do this. So let's say I think this would be easier picture. So we have Thurn. He agrees to pay $100,000 to Rose. So if Rose was to pay, but Rose owes to Flower 20,000. Whatever is happening here is a transaction value. Right? So would it be so in other words, Rose and Flower and Turn, they decide to do the counting trick. So the counting trick here is instead of Turn paying 100 to the Rose and then Rose paying 20 to the Flower, so they settle the debt. Rose said, okay, let's do this. Split it out into the 80 and 20. Because the focus here is 100,000. This 100,000 is not going up and down because Flower will, again, the key part here is agreed to pay for that debt. So in other words, Rose is saying, listen, take instead of paying me 100,000 directly, pay me 80,000 and then pay 20,000 to that other guy. You can pay it to me, but I would prefer you to pay it to that other guy, in this case Flower. And because you're paying it to Flower, this is something which is canceled. If you add it on up, that means you are not canceling the debt, right? If you're doing taxes, and I know we're in the tax season, by the way, I hope everyone got their stimulus checks, right? I hear people have been getting them. So if you look at the if you fill out your taxes, you have a line, especially for corporations. I'm talking about 1120, but I think that's still the same for individuals too. If you let's say you have a credit card debt, and because you didn't pay your bills, they went after you, but after a certain amount of time, they said, okay, that's fine. This amount of money adds on as an income on your declaration because this is a canceled debt. So that other income line item, it goes in because this is the money you would have to pay out, but you didn't have to pay out, so it's an income. Because if I borrow something, it's not an income, I have to pay it back. So same situation here. But the idea of this particular question is to show the example of indirect payment. So, what is to Misabi, to what you are not entitled, let me know because I'm not sure I understand. You're not entitled to forgiveness of debt? Well, we don't really care about that because we know the hypothetical. We know that Rose owes to Flower, right? And Thurn steps into the shoes of Rose and this time to pay off the Flower debt, right? The confusing part, I thought for me, the confusing part would be the $10,000 for the shipping cost. That's the line item. That would be the most confusing one because we know we have to take it out. But if you read the question carefully, that shipping cost is not part of the equation because we're not dealing with the invoice. We're dealing with known numbers. So focus here is on what's relevant. This is in here irrelevant, and customs examiners just threw it there. I thought that would be the difficult one. So the money from the government? Oh. Well, so some people are entitled, some people aren't. I think there is a what's called there is a phase out for this stuff too. But yeah, I was going off tangent. This is not really relevant to the transaction value discussion. So please, let's focus on another one, because I see I made the right choice to actually go through this, because there are unknown underwater rocks that I thought I took care of in the book. Okay, so let's go to the page. Page 473. And we have the aluminum windows. So I want to discuss this question right here. So aluminum windows, we have example of what's known as assist, and I think this is a good stuff to discuss. I know that some of you guys asked me about this before. A good idea to talk about the stuff again. So let's go through this. So U.S. importer contracts for services of a foreign company that works with aluminum to manufacture 300 aluminum windows at $40 per window. And look, at the end of the day, we're looking for the transaction value. So, okay, so you have 300 aluminum windows, $40 each. But that's not the end of the story, because we also have the importer that says, listen, I'm going to send you the tools with which you're going to do that manufacturing thing. And the importer sends them the tools, which is $500, and sends them and pays for the air freight charges, which is $300. And manufacturer says, okay, I'm gonna give you the money, but you pay for it. A month later, U.S. importer receives $300, the cut and assembled windows, accompanied by the invoice of $12,000. So, what is the invoice value? All right, so we have several things that are going on here. Let's start with what counts, what doesn't count. All right. So we'll start with the basic cost of aluminum windows. So that's 300 times 40. Which comes to 12,000. Then we have add-ons. The tool that manufacturer that the importer gave to manufacturer, this is his out-of-pocket expense. And this is something that is called assist. So assist, if you look at if we go back to the quick reference chart that I said that I provide you, is it is down there. It is something which is included in the cost, and this is something which is out of pocket expenses by the importer to make the thing happen. So in this case, it would be. So usually in the world of customs license broker exam, it's the mold. right? But here we have just a tool, right? So we don't know what that tool is. Could be a piece of machinery, whatever. So it's a tool. Since not the manufacturer but the importer borne the expense, it is added on as an asset. So we have to add $500. That's assessed. And assessed is a it's just like what the term would mean to please assist me. Like, let's say I'm in a grocery store you buying something and you need assistance. Can you please assist me in doing this? Can you assist me doing that? Nowadays, I live in New York, so in New York they just passed this law. Well, they passed it a while back, but because of coronavirus, it came out. The enforcement came out late, but pretty much what you have here is in the grocery store. They said no more plastic bags because we care about the environment. And on top of that, if you can use our paper bags because they start using paper bags, but you have to pay, I think, 5 cents per bag, and this is the mandated amount by the law. It is at the legislature level. They have to charge. They even if they want to give it away for free, they can't. So the example of assist, would you like an assistance with getting a bag, a paper bag for your groceries? And if I have a bunch of vegetables here with me, I'll be like, yeah, sure, that would be 5 cents. So that 5 cents would be the assistance charge for providing that paper bag as a part of the grocery purchase. So the idea is the same. If you assist financially or assist, how should I say this, or you assist with some kind of tangible items, in this case it would be a tool, that would be the assistance. So the idea is, what is the value of assistance? Well, here they tell us $500. So because this $500 is assistance that the manufacturer should have incurred. The idea is this: you go to the to the producer, right? You expect them to do all the work for you. You expect them to have the tools. You expect them to have all the stuff. And if he doesn't, he's like, no, that's something you have to pay for. Then this is the cost of assistance, which should have been by the manufacturer from the get-go, but he didn't. The manufacturer requested that, or in this case, the importer, we know, to make aluminum windows, importer provided that $500. And not only he provided that $500, he also said, hey, I'll also pay for the freight, which is $300. Okay, so the assist not only includes, so the transaction value not only includes the tool that was provided to make the stuff happen, but also includes the transportation costs incurred. In this case, they were incurred by the importer. So he paid it up front, right? So this would be $12,800. So then you might ask, okay, what's going on? He got his money back. He got that $300 a month later. So what's going on with that? Well, look at the quick reference chart, you will see rebates. Rebates before the date of importation, if they are given, they are included in the transaction value. So if the if he would send that before the date of, the key point is the date of importation, then you could take it out. So it would be 12,500. It's not even here. But because he received it after, a month later, right? That is not part of the transaction value. Okay, so that's the example. The assist is defined. Let me see. Everyone follows me on this one? So I was talking about, let me see, that assist. So let me talk about a little bit about assist, because assist is part of the definitions here. So you can see 152, 102, and it defines as any of the stuff that supplied directly or indirectly, free of charge or at reduced cost by the buyer to the seller. So that means if the buyer made the supply, or the, in this case, it's usually the importer, it is included. Notice on this a little exception. So if you have engineering, development, artwork, design work, and all that other stuff that were done in the United States. So one example would be, for example, using the Apple Incorporated, which makes phones. They have software engineers, and they have it's an integrated company, so they design hardware. So they have the hardware engineers too, and they make the design in the United States. They make that in California, right? And because they make that in California, this is kind of like intangible intellectual property stuff. That's the way to look at it. Because it was done in California, which was provided to let's say People's Republic of China, or now here they're switching their production to India. Because it was taken in the United States, it's not part of it. Because to simply include, and that kind of makes sense to maintain the competitive advantage, because the competitive advantage would be, imagine engineers are expensive, right? So imagine how much value added you would have to do to make sure that you have to... Your iPhone would cost way more than it costs right now if you had to do that addition. One more thing. So this stuff once you become a licensed customs broker, you deal with that stuff in various ways. Many of the importers, they may not even be aware of it. So I, for example, had a client who had just recently the gold manufacturer, right? But what's done is the gold is being purchased here from pawn shops, from various marketplaces at the bottom below the market value prices. It's being melted, and then it's being shipped to outside of the United States, to in this case it was the Middle East, and it is being melted into the jewelry and returned over here. So it would make sense for gold is a high valued commodity, right? It's a precious metal, so it would make sense, logically speaking, to the person who exports gold, says, okay, why do I have to, since this is a US good return, why do I have to add it as a part of the total price? Because that increased the value of the item being returned tenfold. So, and obviously that potential importer was very upset, because when he found out that he did have to add value of gold as an asset, because he was providing, because of that 152.102 definition, this is a material and component that was provided, in this case gold, that was provided to the overseas melters who make jewelry out of that gold. So you do have to include, you do have to include cost of the gold. Of course, now you're going to through free trade agreements, right? Today your assignments included free trade agreements. So one of the items, for example, in free trade agreement, so I did mention Middle East, right? So I said, well, there is a free trade agreement with Oman, which would allow you to not include that as a part of the assets, but it would have to be the Oman, which was not a particular country of favor in that case. So, so yes, there are exceptions based on free trade agreement provisions, but we're here talking about the general rule. And general rule, if you assist, if the importer assists the manufacturer or the exporter in any kind of way, then that's the part of the situation. So CF-29 notice, so everyone, Katy, thank you for bringing this up. So CF-29 notice is the notice which relates to the duty increase, because you increase instead of $3,000 item, it all of a sudden becomes $53,000 item, right? Because the cost of labor relative to the cost of material in case of gold is much, much smaller. If it was the case, yes, but then I said that particular prospective importer was smart to talk to someone who went through that exercise. And this will, if you are in a world of brokerage, this is most likely will happen to you too at one point or another, because licensed customs brokers are the first points of contact to deal with, and they will so once you get that license, you are deemed to be in a good position to know what to add, what to subtract. And in this hypothetical, if you didn't go through that 152.102, then that CF-29 notice would probably result in your negligent advice, because you should know that, you should know better to know that beforehand. So, and also speaking of procedure, CF-29, sometimes Customs Form 29 is a notice of duty increase. It's usually preceded by Customs Form 28, which is information of, to say, show me why I should not increase that. And both of those forms sometimes show up on the customs license broker exam. So keep that in mind. Okay. So that's for assets. Moving on. Let me see. So that's aluminum windows. Let's talk about Angels accessories. All right. So this is the question that deals with. So this is a question from page 475 of the textbook. I think I can make it. Is it covering? No, it's not covering the whole thing. So that's better. Okay. So can everyone see? Let me make it a little bigger. All right. So you have, again, you are being asked the correct appraised value of the imported barrettes. So that's the item you're trying to figure out the value of. So let's go to the fact pattern and see what's going on with that. All right, so you have retail sale, you have 5,000 dollars to produce 10,000 dollars of barrettes. So from the fact pattern, you know that that 5,000 dollars is something which is included because it's the basic price. So that's the line item which you start, because remember, price actually paid or payable, this is a starting point. And then you have all those add-ons which I provided to you in the chart. So fine, then let's go on. So going on to that $5,000, you have $500 for a mold. So remember, mold is something which is very popular. If you see mold is an assist right away. So that's the basic price. Then you have $500, which is an assist mold for using production. Then you have US produced details, sketches, design and specifications for the barrettes. Recall my example on Apple and engineers, where it would, if you were to use US engineers design work as a price added, then that would increase the price of the iPhones dramatically. So this is an example. See, this is what customs examiners are testing for. They're testing you on exception to the assist. And the exception is that's the $100. Since it was done in the US, hasn't been done in India? No. But since it was done in the US, they have sketches designed, the intellectual property stuff, right? Then you are not using that $100. It's the assist exception. So, yes, you don't count it on. And then you have another $300. And what's that for? You have Sunshine providing fasteners, which Angels acquired from the unrelated company in Thailand for $300. So remember, this is the tangible line item. This is not some kind of the design work or the sketches or the engineering work. This is the metal stuff, which is to be incorporated. It's kind of like that gold that I described, which is to be incorporated into the jewelry. Same thing here. That metal stuff, metal fasteners, they are to be incorporated into the barret. So what we're doing here is we're providing the tangible, and this is an assist. This is an example of an assist. So mold is an assist, and metal fasteners. Does it matter that they are related or not? It doesn't matter, because the focus of the question is who bears the cost. In here, we have the importer, Angels, who bears the cost? That's the ultimate question. Because ultimately, Angels assist the Sunshine to make those barrels. If Sunshine was saying, don't worry about it, this is part of the cost that I'll take care of, then it would not be any, there would not be any assistance by Angels, and there would be no assist. But in this case, Angels went out of its way and to make that assistance. So $300 is in assist 2. So you identified one assist, you identified the assist exception, you identified another assist, and the basic price, which becomes $5,800. That's what you see. All right, now, any questions of that? You're doing good, guys, because we are almost through this. So next one is a question from page 467. This is going to be the last one that I wanted to cover on the transaction value, and after we're done with that, we are pretty in a good shape on the transaction value portion. So let's see what it says. So ACF or AACF shipment has an invoice value of $5,000 and a weight of 12,000 kilograms. So immediately you know that the that weight is either given to mislead you or it is a relevant line item. Okay, moving on. Then you have, by the way, kind of broke the rule. We're looking at the entered value of the shipment. And entered value of the shipment, in this case, is a transaction value. How you know it's a transaction value? Because transaction value is the price actually paid or payable. And we have no other information to suggest, as we read on, although we should be on the lookout, that you should be using some other stuff. Some other information, because recall, going back to our discussion of valuation methodologies, methods, right? Transaction value first, then you have identical merchandise, you have similar merchandise, you have deductive or computed value. So by the time you get past the transaction value, the hint to the transaction value not being available for use is that the parties are related. So subsidiary of Walmart brings in the stuff to the parent company in the United States. Sometimes the customs examiners are being more direct, and I have some examples of that too. They say, well, what is the deductive value? What is the computed value of the merchandise? So they're pretty much telling you what to do. But those are very minor percentage. Again, the transaction value is huge. So let's go back to our question. Okay, so we're looking for the final computational value. So what we're going to start to do is we're going to start piling up the relevant information which we need to later on add or subtract. So how do we do that? Well, we start from the top and we keep on going down. All right, so we know the invoice value is $5,000. So we know 5,000. Well, let's do this. We also know the weight. That's fine. We'll come back to this. The duty rate is 10% plus 2 cents per kilogram. Aha, this is where the weight becomes relevant. So the duty rate is 10% is, let's say, again, I know you may not like me for doing this, but I just gonna say the value of merchandise, the shipment is X. This is what we're getting to, I think. But that's the value of merchandise. You have to pay 10% duty on that value of merchandise, so that will be 0.1x. That's the what's called ad valorem duty. Value of merchandise times 10%. Then we know that, but this is what also known was as a compound rate of duty. So the compound rate of duty is something which is combination of particular percentage and the weight. So the weight here would be 2 cents per kilogram. So we're dealing with dollars. Remember that conversion portion that I mentioned. So it would be 0.02 dollars per kilogram. How many kilos are there? We have 12,000 kilos. 12 times 12,000. That would be what's known as specific duty. Next. Also part of the invoice is the brokerage fees. Remember, going back to the chart, brokerage fees are on another column, so they're not part of the equation. So we have $50 in brokerage fees. So that's brokerage. Who pays $50 for brokerage fees nowadays? Well, in fact, you may be surprised. Some companies pay less than that. All right. Ocean freight cost $600. And you know, ocean freight cost is not part of the transaction value. So this is part of the transaction value. Duties are not part of the transaction value. The brokerage fees are not part of the transaction value. We know the freight is not part of the transaction value. So the freight will be how much? 6,000? Oh, 600. 600 for freight. It's not part of the transaction value. And the duty. Well, we talk about the duty in this part. Okay, so we also have MPF, which is the minimum. Recall the minimum is now is 27 something because of the interest rate adjustment. But it's also $25. Oops. And here they actually tell us, so we just go with what they tell us. $25 for MPF. All right. So then they give us this story. So the importation date is January 31st, but the buyer and seller agreed to a price reduction on February 4th. So price reduction, recall that rebate example? Rebate and the rule of that I wanted to share with you, that rebate rule, it's in the chart, but the key here is after the date of importation. Any rebate is to be disregarded if it is after the date of import. So not the date of import, I'm sorry, not the date of entry summary, not the date of entry, but it's actually the date of importation that counts. So this is what they're testing you for. I mean, I knew I drew it like a little picture over here, but the reason behind the sentence is that date of importation here is January 31st, but the rebate is on February 4th, 2012, right after the date of importation. Yeah, it's before the entry summary, but the date of importation is being operative here. And the importation date here is before the date of discount. So that rebate, that $500 rebate is not part of that equation. So we take that $500 and we disregard it because rebate after importation date of import. So that's important. If you guys ever go to the stores and you see the manufacturer mail in rebate. Take, let's say, I think I my last nice rebate was when I was buying let me see, I think I was buying an external hard drive. So they had a $20 off manufacturer rebate, and guess what they did? So you know, once you buy it, you're paying tax on your rebate. Yeah, I'm sorry. You pay it. So you go to the cashier, to the register, and they charge you tax. When next time when you're going to get your rebate, going to buy your item with instant manufacturer rebate, you will notice that take a look and figure out, was that tax calculated on price before the rebate was applied or after the rebate was applied? And if you guys pay attention to that, then it may help you kind of figure this out with the date of import. But instead of date of import, you put yourself in the shoes of date of payment for the to that register, right? Because when I bought my external hard drive, I paid the full price. I paid the tax on the full price, and only then the rebate was applied. In other words, the rebate wasn't, I think it was like $120 with $20 instant manufacturer rebate. So up, it was 119, something like that, but let's say it's 120. I paid tax on 120 and then the rebate was applied. Normally what we as consumers are thinking, and I kind of thought of that before doing this, that I would be paying tax after the application of the rebate. So if that is helpful to you, if this is something, if you're frugal, if you're doing this stuff, buying stuff with instant manufacturer rebates or coupons, this is something that you may help you as a yardstick. All right, so let's go to, so we know this is to be disregarded. So what should be the entered value? So I decided, so I have someone already doing the math for me. I actually have the spreadsheet, which I think would be good for us in this particular situation. So we know that we have the invoice value. So let me bring it up on the screen so you guys can see it better. So we know we have the invoice value of 5,000, right? They tell us that right off the bat. And we know the components, right? The components are value of merchandise, ad valorem, specific duty, brokerage fees, ocean freight, and MPF. The specific duty, brokerage fees, ocean freight, and MPF we can take out right away. So that will leave us with $4,085. This is where we take them out. And then we apply that X formula that we started with, because we have 10% duty applied to 100% of the value of merchandise. Because we deal with percentages, the hundredth part. And I think Katya did a good job on showing that this is hundredth part. So we ended up with 1.1x equals 485. You bring x over and divide it, 485 divided by 1.1, which is neatly shown in that formula, G17 by I17. And you get 3713, 63 something. And going back to that question, rounded up, 3714 is the line item that fits the bill. So that's the answer for you right there. Yes. Okay, so guys, before I thought that it will take me 1 hour to cover this, but I realized that I was very ambitious. So listen, how about we're gonna have more classes at the end. I'll add them up. How about we just call it tonight and night, and go to anti-dumping duties, because I have a feeling this topic in itself was good enough. So let's wrap it up, because remember we started off with this guy, right? That exam question 78. So this whole speech was a prelude to that question 78 of the custom license broker exam, which was given on October PM 2020, the very last exam. So after going through all these previous hypotheticals, we should be in a good shape to say, okay, what's counted, what's not. Okay, so here, what do we count in and what do we count out? So we have stainless steel. So we have a commercial invoice. And that commercial invoice we're looking for the transaction value, right? And that commercial invoice provides for the line item breakdown. So we have 50,000 of, I'll be reading that and drawing it on the board too. So we have 50,000 stainless steel cookware, which has a unit value of $3 each. We have here, remember that indirect payment stuff that the customs examiners talked, that we talked in the context of the debt settlement, that flour company being the recipient of that 20,000. So this is actually easier, because they are kind of telling you right away, this is an indirect payment. But we have 50,000 units with a unit value of $3 each. So 50,000 times 3, it would be $150,000. That's the unit. That's the total value for the stainless steel cookware. Then we have indirect payments. We know that indirect payments are part of the equation, right? Because from the debt settlement. So 50, if not, you have the chart. So you add the indirect payments on. So that's indirect payments. Which are part of the transaction value. So far you have $200,000, which are part of the transaction value. Then you have $5,000 for the shipping insurance. This is insurance. Insurance is not part of the transaction value, so we do not add it. We have 10,000 for ocean freight. Is the ocean freight part of the transaction value? No, it's not. Customs duties are not part of the transaction value. Insurance, incident, as long as it's incident to international shipment, right? No, if it was after the importation, it was like, let's say you brought it to the port of, let's say, Newark, New Jersey, and you put it on a truck and you send it out to Chicago. Is that part of the transaction value? No. So here you do not include that. So the answer is $200,000. That's answer choice E. So we did through all that footwork to get to that 200,000.